let us begin this final part by mentioning some computations which have not been done in connection to the Hall problem, but are quite interesting for their own sake, and offer a totally new view of the quantum versus classical debate. First of all, let's just, as an insert, mention Capello's ad hoc conceptual inequalities, which are not derived by solving some Hall problem. One can ease the rules of the two-valued states by just considering any binary value assignment, provided that it is not context dependent. So the value assignment should be global, should be valid on all contexts, irrespective of the particular context. In particular, link observables should have the same value that doesn't depend on which particular context is considered. Intertwining observables. And you can have all kinds of value assignments. Let's say you can have in a context with three atoms, you can have all three of them true, or you can have just two of them true, or none of them true. And then you consider particular configurations suggested by quantum mechanics. Capello in particular considered a configuration that was developed by himself, by Estebanz and Garcia Alcaine some time ago, which has no classical two-valued state. Mind you, it is correct that this configuration has no two-valued state, but it can still have generalized states where the rules are eased. One can debate whether this has anything to do with physics, but mathematically it's okay to just assume that one can have anything. And if one can have anything, then of course there exists a lot of states. Actually, Capello et al.'s configuration involves 18 binary observables, and from these 18 binary observables, you then have 2^18 vertices, and or value assignments. And then Capello did the following thing. He asked himself, if I multiply this configuration involves 9 contexts. Let me just draw them here in a hyperdiagram. So this is this configuration. 9 contexts. So this is the 8th context, and the 9th is here. And there are 4 atoms per context. Yeah. And he multiplies, he first considers binary observables that are either -1 or 1, and he multiplies per context, he multiplies all observables together. So there are 4 factors. And then he sums up all these products of the 9 contexts. And then he asks himself, well, what is the sum of these products? So there are 9 terms to the sum. And what he finds out is that they have a minimum that is -7. Indeed, I have rechecked this computation. There are 9,216 such cases that this sum is minus 7. There is no minus 8 and no minus 9. But on the other hand, by simple quantum mechanical argument, he tries to compute the quantum prediction with these observables. These are also binary observables, quantum observables, with binary eigenvalues minus 1 and 1. And the vectors EI form an orthonormal basis. And if that is the case, then one gets per context a minus 1 here, minus 1 here, which means that if you evaluate the respective eigenvalues, this is a minus 1. And if you got these 9 contexts, the sum of these 9 contexts, then you always have expectation values of minus 1 regardless of the state. And this should be compared to the minus 7 here, and this is obviously a contradiction. So of course you can only, as they are complementary, you can only observe one after another, but one can check if really these 9 observables, one after another, or multiplied together, the quantum ones, render minus 1 as a product. And then you sum it up, 9 of them renders minus 9, which is in direct contradiction to the classical prediction minus 7. Let me just re-emphasize that this is no Hall computation, and the bound from below is no Boolean type inequality. It's just an enumeration, a kind of brute force method to obtain such a bound. Now we come to another important subject, that is quantum gadgets. And quantum gadgets have been used by originally Kochner and Spekker as part of their construction of a graph that doesn't allow any state at all. But these gadgets, this is a technical term, still allow two-valued states and still allow a faithful set embedding into a Boolean, into a larger Boolean subalgebra, some of them. At least the one I will introduce now, this is the so-called Spekker bug. I call it Spekker bug because I once invited Professor Spekker to Vienna, and he gave a talk, and he had a slide, this slide he thinks looks like of the graph of this structure, and this graph looks like a Käfer, and Käfer is the German word for bug, so I call it Spekker bug. And actually this was invented 2 years, or introduced 2 years before the famous Kochner and Spekker paper, also by Kochner and Spekker, in a publication that was published in 1965, referring to a conference that was even 2 years earlier. And this configuration has a very interesting property. If you assume that you prepare a state, a physical system in the state A1, then you can ask, what is the probability to find this physical system in A7? Now, if you do a classical analysis, that is, if you look at all the, there are 14 two-valued states, so you have to look at all the 14 two-valued states, you will get the fact that if you if you prepare it in that state, this is the probability here, the probabilities on the other terminal, I call this terminal, yeah, here this is an input terminal, this is associated with a preselection. So if you preselect to be in one of those three cases corresponding to three two-valued states, it can't be in this state here because these are disjoint. Yeah. So one, the first, the second, and the third state, they are not true on A7. A7 is only true on the sixth state, on the 13th state, and on the 14th state. Here's the Trevis matrix. You can verify that this is true. So you get the result that whenever you preselect or prepare a particle in A1, classically, the classical prediction is that it will never occur in A7. Yeah. So this is why it is called true implies false gadget. True implies false gadget or TIFF gadget. And there have been numerous such TIFF gadgets introduced in the literature or the same discussed or rediscussed. For instance, Pitofsky calls it cat's cradle. Just like the Specker buckets, just a name for the same gadget. And Hardy has given an example. Hardy's famous example was in a four-dimensional gadget. True implies false gadget. And despite this direct proof, by enumerating all the classical probabilities, there is a quite straightforward proof by contradiction that A1 and A7 can never have the same true value. They can have the same false true value. So A1 and A7 can be false both. That is still allowed, but it cannot happen in the classical interpretation that they are both true at the same time. Let's assume that they are. This is a wrong assumption. Yeah, this is a proof by contradiction. Well, if they are, then you draw this assumption here. And then as a direct consequence, you see that these propositions must be false or have all value zero. Now, if these have value zero, it immediately follows that this and this has to be true also. And you have a direct contradiction. Why? Because it cannot be that within one context, this is this middle context, there are two true statements. Only one statement has to be true. So this is a direct consequence. And I just want to mention that TIFF gadgets in general are symmetric with respect to an exchange of their terminal points. Yeah, so you can start with A7 to be true, then A1 must be false because, well, the whole configuration is symmetric, but this is in general true as you can imagine. On the other hand, if you look at an orthogonal, faithful orthogonal representation, a vertex characterization by vectors, you find out I gave you just one of them, that you can have A1 to be 1, 0, 0, and the other one to be, this is a non-normalized vector, 1, 2 times square root of 2, 0. And if you, I mean, of course, normalization would require this to be 1/3, 1/2 square root of 2, 0. And if you form the scalar product, this is just in real space, this is just the Euclidean product, and form the square, 1 times 1 is 1. And 1/3 squared is 1/9. You get a probability that in 1 out of 9 cases, you observe A7 quantum mechanically, although you have prepared the system to be in A1. And this is in direct contradiction to the classical prediction. It doesn't always occur, yeah, but in 1 out of 9 cases, it occurs. So, and I call this you may call it the angle, the aperture between these two terminal points. Yeah. You can then go on and extend this true implies false gadget to a true implies true gadget by adding 3 more points. And Cochin and Specker did that. This is their gamma one graph. In the famous Cochin and Specker paper, I cited it here. And this gamma one graph of Cochin and Specker consists of a bug, an extended bug that extends that is extended by 2 contexts, 1 context here and 1 context here, and they are intertwined in this common element, common to 2 contexts. And what you then get is that if A1 is true, then C must be false, and this must also be false, of course. But this is a TIFF gadget, so this has to be false again. And now we come to the conclusion: if A1 is true, this has to be true as well. The B1 has also to be true as well. Yeah. So this serves as a TIT gadget, a true implies true gadget. Now, of course, one may again ask, what is the probability there? And again, one has, after normalization, one has, I believe, 1/3 minus 2 square root of 2, 1, 0. And if I take then A1, B1, I arrive at the conclusion that it is true that you get B1 if you prepare A1 in, 8, that is 2 times 2. It's basically you have minus 2 square root of 2/3, which is basically squared, which is basically in 8 out of 9 trials, this is the prediction you will get true. But in 1 out of these 9, if you take a large sample size, you will get a contradiction with the classical prediction that B1 has to be 1. I mean, it's also most of the cases in 8/9 of the cases, it's also true quantum mechanically, but for this particular configuration, you get in 1 out of 9 cases that this is false, that B1 is false. And this is again in direct contradiction to quantum mechanics. And what Cochin and Specker did is they constructed their gamma 2, and this gamma 2 is the full graph that contains this TIT gadget in a serial composition. Yeah, so you can take the first terminal point and then extend it to the next point the B1, so you extend A1 to B1, and you extend the B1 to C1, and so on and so forth. And these have all to be, since these are TIT gadgets, serially composed, the extended terminal point is transitive. Yeah, this feature A1 and C1 would have to be one. And if you do that in a suitable faithful orthogonal representation, you will end up in two vectors that have an associated classical truth value of one and are orthogonal. Yeah, and are orthogonal. And this cannot be quantum mechanically, because quantum mechanically these are in another context, and there's a contradiction with the axioms of two-valued measures, because inside of a single context there can only be one, and the other, let's say if you have three-dimensional spaces, the other two propositions have to be false then. But if you extend that, you get you get after some time, actually, as far as I remember, Kochenspecker did it 5 times, this extension, you get that within the same context, classical prediction is that there are two true value assignments, which is in clear contradiction to the assumptions. Okay, but Kochenspecker went a little bit further. This is their gamma 3. They went a little bit further in considering a structure which cannot resolve by classical means different atoms. So quantum mechanically, you have different vertex labelings by faithful orthogonal representations, namely, for instance, A1 and B1, or A7 and B7. But classically, you cannot resolve, because if you introduce an additional TIF gadget, this renders the following situation. If A1 is one, B1 has to be one, and vice versa now. Yeah, because you have introduced another TIF gadget. I mean, so if B1 is one, A1 has to be one. And the same is true also for A7 and B7. So if A7 is true, then B7 has to be true, and vice versa. And this renders a situation where classically, by classical means, by classical two-valued states, you cannot differentiate operationally between A1 and B1 and A7 and B7. I mean, of course, you have to prove, and Kochenspecker did that this structure, this entire structure, has a faithful orthogonal representation in the sense of Lovach. But it has. Yeah. So this is an instance which is very important, where you cannot faithfully, that is structure preserve in a structure preserving way, embed such a graph into a larger Boolean subalgebra. And this is covered by Kochenspecker theorem 0, which I encourage you to look at in the original famous paper. Not many people mentioned this, but it's very important. It's a kind of demarcation criterion. If you can separate by classical means two propositions, then you have the possibility of classical embedding this bag of observables into a larger Boolean subalgebra. If you cannot, like in this gamma 3 case, Then you cannot embed this. So this is a kind of demarcation criterion between between embeddability and non-embeddability, which I think is a very important criterion. Now let's come to even weirder configurations. The next two slides are basically the last two slides I will consider, or the two configurations. The first configuration is a dual configuration with very similar observables. One serves as a TIFF gadget from A to B, and from B to A, of course, but we are only interested in this direction. And one is a TIT gadget from A to B, yeah? And all these points, these are, you know, what I have drawn here are the single possible two-valued states that you have if you assume that A is true. There exists only one such state in each case, and the observables are all the same, basically. So if you have a faithful orthogonal representation of this TIT gadget, for instance, this point here is equal to that point here, has the same label, has the same vertex label. Yeah. And let's now concentrate on what this says classically. According to this classical interpretation, if A is true or has the value one, then according to the TIFF gadget here, according to this one, B cannot be true. B has to be false. And likewise, if according to this TIT gadget A is true, then B cannot be false. Now, if you merge these two cases, then you get arrive at the complete contradiction, because if A is true, then B cannot be true on the one hand and cannot be false on the other hand. So what is it then? And one answer to that, one escape to that is that B has to be indeterminate or value indefinite. Yeah, you can think of this as partial function, the truth assignment, and this partial function is not has no value for B. In the sense of Cluny, partial function in the sense of Cluny. And very similar, this was done, the whole graph was introduced in a paper by Abbott, Kalude and myself. And there exists a previous work by Pitofsky very much in the same direction. I gave you this reference here. But it can get even weirder, you know? It can get even weirder. If you look at the full graph that was introduced in the work of Abbott, Kalude and myself, you might also look at all the available two-valued measures. See, this graph still has two-valued measures, still has classical interpretations, but these classical interpretations show some kinds of, how should I say, problems or peculiarities, because if all these classical interpretations require that this central observable has to be one, this central observable, yeah, the A1, and of course all that are connected to that, and there are one, two, three, four contexts connected to that, and their respective observables here. So the connected observables which share the same point A1, so they intertwine in this point, these observables have to be zero. So A1 must be true according to all classical interpretations. Yeah, there exist 8 classical interpretations, and in all of them, A1 must be true, and the orthogonal observables A2, A13, A15, A16, 17, 25, 27, 36 must be false. So what does that mean? I mean, in particular, if you parameterize a quantum mechanical system, you can always rotate a pure state to be in either one or in two, in either A1 or in A2. Yeah, this is just a rotation that wouldn't change anything. And then what would a consequence be? The consequence would be that if I look into that configuration, then this rotated configuration, and if I identify a particular state with A1, I would have to assume that according to the classical interpretation, this cannot be prepared in state. This must be prepared in state one and cannot not be prepared in state one. And on the other hand, you can infer from this graph that if you rotate it into A2, it shouldn't be able to be prepared in state A2 according to the classical prediction. Yeah, it should always be false, which is also absurd. And this, in my opinion, presents an eclipse or the end of this kind of graph theoretical consideration in quantum mechanics. One can derive an immediate, almost trivially testable contradiction relative to the assumption of classical value definiteness. Okay, we are at the end of this brief introduction to quantum weirdness. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you profited a little bit from these thoughts. Thank you and goodbye.